Welcome to worship with the United Methodist Church of Antioch. I am Pastor Katie, and it is good for us to gather together and worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We do have a few announcements on this third Sunday in Lent. The update on our air purification system that we've now been talking about for a few weeks. We needed to, for our part of this, raise about $4,500. We are at $4,360. So close, friends, so close. Any amount that goes over that to pay for the air purification system that we've already installed and is already working on our behalf will go towards standalone units for the two offices that are in the church. So any amount over that we have an earmark for that same air purification idea. So if you can help us reach that goal, we would be very grateful. Next Sunday is UMCOR Sunday. UMCOR stands for United Methodist Committee on Relief. Through UMCOR Sunday in the United Methodist Church worldwide, we commit to this one Sunday a year to raising their administrative costs. This is how UMCOR has any money they need to be able to stand ready, to be able to respond to disasters in our country and worldwide. So that when something happens and we put out the call to a disaster somewhere and we say, UMCOR is collecting for whatever project, and we can say 100% of your donations will go to that disaster project, that is because we collect the UMCOR Sunday offering. So the offering that we will collect next Sunday for UMCOR goes to their administrative costs so that they can be organized and they can have all of the people in places and they can do the trainings and they can do all of those things that they need to do to be able to respond as ready. We do have a video for you to watch about that now.
When disaster strikes, we all want to help. But when days are dark, you can't always be there to show the love of Jesus to the suffering. But someone should be there. And someone is. And you are the one who makes it happen. How? By your generous giving to UMCOR Sunday. Your support enables the United Methodist Committee on Relief, UMCOR, to act as the hands and feet of Christ, embracing and supporting those in need through their darkest days. Thanks to your gift on this special Sunday of the United Methodist Church, UMCOR is able to provide relief and long-term support for recovery. Not only do we provide immediate emergency assistance in the aftermath of a crisis, we also create sustainable solutions in the following months, even years of recovery, long after everyone else has gone home. Your gifts form a firm foundation, a base for operations from which UMCOR can reach and serve the hurting. Your giving enables UMCOR to keep the promise that all gifts given to help a specific cause go 100% toward meeting that need. For more than 75 years, UMCOR has met the needs of the suffering. And today, we continue that labor of love and service in 80 countries around the world. Thanks to you and your generous support through UMCOR Sunday, UMCOR will continue to be there this year to show the love of Christ to children, families, and communities when disaster strikes. Because together, we do more.
We want to let you know that Dolores Randall has passed away, and so her memorial service will be at church on March 20th at 1 p.m. Family and friends are invited to this memorial service, but due to COVID restrictions, attendance is limited. If you are interested in attending, we do need you to make reservations for this service. Those are being coordinated with Carlene Worcester, and her phone number is in the bulletin that you can download with this worship service. So please contact her. She's coordinating with the family to make sure that between the family coming and friends and brothers and sisters in faith who want to attend, that we don't go over our 50-person limit right now. So please make sure you coordinate with Carlene to make sure that we keep to the COVID requirements at this point. If you'd like to donate for Easter flowers, the information for that is in the bulletin as well. We've talked about that for a few Sundays, so I won't continue to bore you with that information, but please know that that's there. Check that out. The due date is March 29th, which is the Monday before Easter. Crucial bit of information here for all of us, because none of us know what day of the week it is ever anymore. Next weekend is spring ahead. So this is your reminder to change your clocks next Saturday night, right? So, you know, who knows if you'll know when that is by then, but this is, I've now done my part to remind you a week early. So there you go. We also have one more video announcement this week. This one comes from Staff Parish Relations Committee. So check out this announcement. And with that, then we turn to Heidi, if you would lead us in worship today.
I didn't unmute myself, sorry. The mission of the United Methodist Church of Antioch is to grow in faith, to worship God following the teachings of Jesus Christ, and to be instruments of God's love through the Holy Spirit as we reach out to our community and the world.
We are welcomed to worship. Jesus Christ is all we need.
Well, Pastor, I hate to disagree, but I need food and water and sleep, and I like shelter. You know, some basics.
I think you know what I meant. Actually, I think we are both right.
I can go with us both being right.
Some days we spend so much time trying to be right that we forget to look to the one who comforts us, even when we're wrong.
When we are wrong, may we acknowledge that and seek forgiveness from God.
Our opening hymn is 295, In the Cross of Christ, I Glory.
Now for our opening prayer. O Lord, who is the way, the truth, and the life, we come to you now confessing that we need you. We need you to get our attention. We need you to teach us. We need you to show us the way. As we lay aside all the points to distractions, use this time to do just that. Lord, may your influence on our lives spill over into others' lives so that they too can focus on you. And now, O God, hear us as we pray, as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hey, everybody. It's great to see you again this week. Okay, librarian alert again. Sorry, just can't get away from it. I have to plug another book. So I want to show you this book. I wish I had the cover of this book, the actual book jacket. I don't, because a goat ate it. And I'm not lying about that. A goat actually ate it. It was in the line of duty as a librarian. It's a long story for another day. But anyway, the book I want to tell you about is called Hello Neighbor, The Kind and Caring World of Mr. Rogers. And it is by Matthew Cordell. One, it is a wonderful, beautiful book. And two, it's kind of cool because Matthew Cordell actually lives near us. He lives in Gurnee, Illinois, and he is actually the winner, not for this book, for another book, of the top prize in the entire country for picture book illustration, the Caldecott Medal. He won it a couple years ago. Wonderful person. such a great, and this book is wonderful, and it's about a person. This is a biography. A biography is a book that talks about, it gives facts and information about somebody's life. And this is the authorized picture book biography of Mr. Rogers. And some of you might not know who Mr. Rogers is. So I'm going to show you a picture. There he is. All right, with the glare there. That's Mr. Rogers. He looks like a nice fellow, isn't he? Yeah, he was a really nice guy. He's no longer with us. He passed away a few years ago. But Mr. Rogers did a show called Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And that show ran for more than 30 years. And it was a really wonderful program. And Mr. Rogers, it was a show for kids. And he talked about all kinds of things. He talked about the important things that kids feel and learn as they grow. And he even talked about really hard things. But he did it in a way that respected kids. You know, he didn't talk down to kids. He was just a wonderful person. And one of the most wonderful things about him was that he loved everyone. And he saw the specialness in everyone. And I'm not going to sing it, but parts of the theme song to Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood goes like this. I've always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. And it goes on later. Won't you please, please won't you be my neighbor? Pastor Katie's singing along. And so is Nicole. Heidi, Debbie, are you singing along? So you ask the question, well, you know, what does that mean? What is a neighbor? We all know what a neighbor is, right? That's somebody, you know, the way we think about it, a neighbor is somebody who lives close to you, maybe next door, right? And a neighborhood, you know, a community of people who live in the same place and they interact, they do stuff, you know, together. But our Bible story today actually calls us to think a little broader about the idea of neighbor and neighborhood. And so I said we were done with the parables. I didn't lie. We're going to go back to some now. Changing stuff, right? So we are going to read another parable. And it is, if you remember, parables are stories that Jesus told to teach people lessons about how to live. And our parable today is called the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, back in Jesus's time, there were a couple of groups of people, the Samaritans and the Jewish people. They did not like each other. No, sorry. They did not trust each other. Mm-mm. No. So keep that in mind when I read this story of the parable of the Good Samaritan. And this, I'm going to read out of our storybook Bible, and it comes from the book of Luke. Here we go. People knew they should love their neighbors, but many Jewish people and Samaritans did not like each other. So Jesus told a parable to teach about neighbors. A Jewish man walked along the road to Jericho. Suddenly, a group of robbers attacked him. They hurt him, stole his money, and left him lying by the side of the road. A priest walked along the road toward the hurt man. The hurt man called out for help, but the priest looked in the other direction. He's not my neighbor. No time to stop, the priest thought as he hurried away. Soon, the man saw a woman and her son coming near, but the woman reacted just like the priest. He's not my neighbor. I'd better keep going, she thought as she rushed away. Another person was walking toward the man. Oh no, a Samaritan! The man worried that the Samaritan would hurt him too. But the Samaritan knelt down next to the man and helped him up. You're my neighbor. I'll bandage your wounds. I'll find you a safe place to rest, the Samaritan said. The Samaritan brought the hurt man to an inn and paid the innkeeper to care for him until he was healed. Neighbors help people in need, not just their family and friends. The Samaritan man helped the Jewish man, even though Samaritans and Jewish people didn't like each other. Jesus taught that we should all be neighbors to each other, even people we don't like. So, the Samaritans and Jewish people didn't like each other. When the Jewish man saw the Samaritan coming, he was, oh no, I've just been hurt and harmed, and this person isn't going to help me, just like the other people aren't going to help me, but worse, he's going to hurt me. But what happened? The Samaritan helped him, and he got the man help and paid for him to be cared for at an inn. So the way to think about this story, I think, for me anyway, and I like to think about it too through the lens of Mr. Rogers, is that Jesus teaches us to think of the world as our neighborhood, to think of others as our neighbors. Maybe they don't live close to us where their houses are, but they should live close to our heart. He wants us to love our neighbors as ourselves. And during Lent, this story reminds us even more too about how Jesus would do the ultimate act of love for us, sacrificing himself for us. So he really wants us to not only love with words, but with works. Let's pray. Dear God, you challenge us to see how every person can be our neighbor. When we use our hearts and hands together, we are showing your love to all people. Amen.
Our middle hymn today is 3122, Christ Has Broken Down the Wall.
Is a call to mission in that hymn. We will tear down walls. We will break down the barriers that get in the way between us and God, between us and our neighbors, as Elisa talked about, and between others and God. We have a call in that. As we come before God in a time of prayer, there are many for us to keep in mind that I'm aware of today. We want to keep in mind those who are hospitalized, those who have cancer, those who are waiting for surgery, those who are recovering from surgery, those who are grieving and who are traveling to be with family for services at this time. We want to keep in mind those who are on hospice in that liminal space where even at this point, we don't know, you know, what might have occurred beyond our knowing, but we pray with them and their families in this waiting time. And we do have a joy to lift up today. Our preschool has a reopening date to announce, and we lift that and celebrate that of March 23rd. So we celebrate that, and Kim did want to extend her gratitude to the preschool board and the return team for all they did in working together to get all of the things in place to make sure that this was as successful as possible. And we do invite you to pray continuously now for the ongoing health and safety of the teachers, of the students who will come and join in this shortened school year. But we do celebrate that we have gotten to a point where we could do this and be comfortable with that and allow that option for families. And so, but in that joy, we're excited about that option. We do want to keep those who will be coming back into our building in our prayers as well. So lots to be thinking about and praying about this week. And I know that there are always things that are always concerns and joys for all of you as well. So I invite us now into a time of silent prayer where we can take all of these things to God, and then I will lead us in a pastoral prayer. So let us pray. God of redemption and hope, as we continue to reflect and repent of our sin during this season of Lent, we do so because you first loved us and you have called us into a deeper relationship with you. Help us to focus on you and your love for us and the world you created. We want to love with that same kind of love. Sometimes, Lord, we discover that we think we know everything. And then we think that we should tell people all the everything that we know because we think we know more than other people do. So Lord, please forgive us when we step on others' toes, when we do that. Forgive us when we run roughshod over you, God. Help us to learn to listen and be still. As we continue to navigate this pandemic world, Lord, we remember families who are grieving. We think of those whose work life hasn't changed one iota, with the exception of personal protective devices. We think of those whose lives have been completely upended and now just want something, anything that resembles normalcy. They don't even necessarily want normal anymore. They just want something that resembles normalcy. Be with all of us during this time. We pray, Lord, for the vaccine rollout in our country and around the world. We know that stopping it here alone won't stop the virus as we move around the world, as we begin to travel again. Help us to care about everyone around the world, that extending of who our neighbor is. Help us to care about stopping this virus as entirely as we can. Help us to truly love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Be with those in our surrounding community who are struggling. Whenever possible, may we be your hands in this world, so that people will know that you love and care about them. We pray all this in the loving and forgiving name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
We ask for understanding. During this season of repentance and reflection, we ask that you would open us to hear your message and the scripture lesson we're about to hear. Use this season in your word to deepen our connections to you and each other. In Christ's name we pray, amen. The reading is from 1 Corinthians 1, 18 through 25. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews, and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be precious in your hearing this day. Amen. Have you ever had someone in your life who just knew how life was supposed to be? Or more to the point, who knew how your life was supposed to be? Because folks like that are never shy about telling us how we're living our lives wrong, right? They always seem to just have a suggestion, right? It starts when we're young and they know like how we should dress or how we should do our hair. And then as we get older, they know which school we should go to, what our major should be, who we should marry. And then, you know, like how we should parent our children, should we have them, you know, or if we should have them at all. You know, like they know all of these things about our lives when they're not living them, right? Or maybe, like, this is where I might be crossing a line from like preaching to meddling, right? Maybe we might be these people for others. Maybe. Yikers, right? Because it can be difficult to just keep our mouths shut when we see others doing something that we just know is wrong, right? Why on earth would they wear their hair like that? Right? I mean, shouldn't we tell them that that's not how it should be? You know, I mean, right? I mean, and Jesus even has these people in his life. We heard about one of them last week. When Jesus rebukes Peter, it was because Peter had pulled him aside and tried to tell him how it was actually supposed to be for the Messiah, right? Jesus had started to tell them that the Messiah was going to suffer and die. And Peter was like, nope, that's not how the story's supposed to go. Jesus, do you not remember? I didn't sign up for that. You're talking about death and, you know, As humans, we are very set in our expectations. When someone tries to correct us or show us a better way, teach us maybe some facts that contradict what we've always understood to be true, well, we pretty much lose our minds. Have you noticed that? It isn't pretty, friends. We get defensive. We tell others what to do. We can get loud or like almost the reverse. We can shut down. Like we just... like, I'm not dealing with this anymore. I'm done talking to you. You're just wrong and I'm gonna leave now, right? But none of those options really helps the situation or helps us to grow in who Jesus is calling us to be. In today's text, that's reading from 1 Corinthians, we get a peek into this strange Christian world of ours, but from a different perspective, right? If we just keep looking at our faith the same way that we've always seen it, that's all we'll ever know. We think it's the greatest thing ever. Jesus is awesome. Like, sure, we understand why we call Good Friday good, right? If somebody from the outside looks at that, they're like, but your guy is hanging on a cross, huh? Right? There are some things that are confusing. So Paul is writing to the church at Corinth in a time of division and separation within that church. He's reminding them that what people see from the outside is not the same as what people see from the inside, which can be a bit of a challenge when it comes to sharing the message of Jesus with others. So we're going to dive into how Paul wanders through these differences a little bit this morning. Ian Markham writes about it this way. He writes, "The message is paradoxical. God's definitive disclosure of what God is like is powerlessness. The creator of the universe, whom we understandably associate with power, after all, the universe is a big entity to create, right? Reveals God's true nature by becoming weak and vulnerable. It's difficult for anyone to understand. So it's not surprising that Paul's Jewish and Greek contemporaries both find it puzzling. It's not simply the message that's paradoxical, though, but also the community in which the message is birthed. The church is not made up of the powerful, the wise, the aristocratic, but the weak, the foolish, and the poor. God wants a countercultural community to witness to a paradoxical gospel. Couldn't God just make it plain? But no. In an echo of the Gospels, then, those least esteemed become the most important in the church. So the God who people expect to be supremely huge and all-powerful chooses to become vulnerable and come to earth in human form. And not only that, but submits to death on a cross. And the people who pick up and then tell this story on through the ages, the people who find redemption and hope in the story of God, who comes first in human form, are not the kings and the rulers, but they're the peasants and the poor. Remember the shepherds, right? The savior of the world arrives needing diapers, right, friends? And the leaders of the day do what they can to limit the threat, but ultimately figure that they've done what they could, and so they don't really need to worry about a kid because the savior of the world is supposed to arrive conquering. So they did what they could, and they're just not going to worry about it because a kid's not going to be able to do anything anyway, right? I mean, besides that, a kid born to unremarkable parents? I mean, who are those people? They're not royalty. Ultimately gets dismissed as not going to matter one iota to history. Oopsies. So those rulers and kings, those who are caught up in the power and the gold, are the ones in the end who will lose their lives. They're so caught up in the trappings of this world that they can't step outside of themselves to submit to another. And then Markham asks a very good question. He asks, why do it this way? Paul explains that the focus on the inadequate is a necessary condition for true faith. He continues, when we see the power of God at work in the powerlessness, and we see that those granted the gift of faith are the least able, our pride should dissipate. We cannot boast in our own efforts, but only in what God in Christ has done for us. It's no longer about ourselves or about what we've done, what our retirement accounts look like, like whatever the variety of options exist in our closets, the cars we drive, how fancy a snowblower or a lawnmower we maneuver around through the seasons, doesn't matter. It's about who Jesus is and what he has accomplished on behalf of all of us. When we surrender to Christ's will and his way, when we decide that God's will is ultimately more important than ours, then and only then do we begin to find life in a new way. When we set aside the trappings of this world, will we find new life and life abundant. Adam Eckhart puts it this way: if the perishing is our doing, the saving is God's doing. By the surprising ultimate power of the cross, God says no to the apparent logic that everything moves toward death. Jesus, nailed to the cross by those who sought to overpower and outlast him, embraces his suffering and death rather than rage against it. Christ takes the crucifixion as an entry point into the saving power of God, and through it denies death the final word. The new understanding is that we belong to God who is saving us, that we belong to God who is saving us. Now, some of us spend a lot of time trying to think our way through or out of this paradox because we want everything to work out the way the plan said. We want all of the pieces to fall into place like a jigsaw puzzle. We want the picture to be lovely. We want it to match the box, right? I mean, and John Wesley certainly would have affirmed the use of our brain as we navigate through our faith. Absolutely. Our faith should make sense, but it can't just make sense, friends. At some point, there has to be a heart conversion so that our whole selves, our heart and our head are involved in our understanding of who Jesus is. It can't be just something that we think about. It has to be something that we come to know too. John Vonderbrugge challenges us around this part of it. Paul offers a warning to the educated modern reader, no less than to the educated elite of his original audience. Wisdom alone is insufficient for understanding God. I need to say that part again. Wisdom alone is insufficient for understanding God unless it first embraces the proclamation of a crucified Savior. The gospel challenges human intellect, not so much to a duel of wits, but to submission to the proclamation, right? We talked about submission earlier with those kings and rulers. And should the intellect insist on a duel nonetheless, Paul is not worried. The gospel, the proclamation of the Savior that lost everything, has already won. The proclamation of the Savior that lost everything has already won. Now, admittedly, there are parts of this text, some of the words in this reading can either make us feel really comfortable to give us that warm, fuzzy, oh yeah, I remember this. This feels like something I'm used to. I remember this is a good churchy feeling. We're really comfortable with that language. Or for others of us, depending on our church experience, it might give us the heebie-jeebies, right? Like some of us have had not so great church experiences. So if we've had great church experiences, we might not spend a lot of time thinking about it because we find comfort in this language. But for others of us, we might be wary. So Jeff Pascal helps us to navigate some of this language territory, right? He writes, we affirm God's supreme revelation in Christ and God's unique act of salvation in the cross of Christ. Yet we are aware that most of the world's people are not Christian. In a multicultural, multi-faith world, what does it mean to lift up the cross, yet be humble among non-Christians? How do we talk about those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved? Right? Kind of sounds a little braggy in there, doesn't it? He continues, maybe one avenue would be to admit with reformer John Calvin that we do not know the final destination of other human beings. God judges. We do not. God alone knows those who are perishing. Certainly we preach, teach, and attempt to live the Christian life. Absolutely, we work for justice and we correct error with humility, always remembering our own sinfulness. But we leave judgment in the hands of God, who is completely just and utterly merciful. And then he continues, being saved is another of Paul's phrases here that does not exactly roll off the tongue of all Christians every day. For many of us, the phrase smacks of emotionally manipulative appeals to get saved or burn in hell forever, right? So it might be useful here to remember that going back to its Hebrew roots, salvation carries the sense of making broad, making roomy, providing space. Certainly being saved then means eternal life when we die, but just as importantly, it means being given a broader, freer, more loving life now. Eternal life starts now, friends. So we can make space. We can make space for God to do what God is going to do while still speaking of our faith in Jesus Christ and allowing people to come to know why that matters to us. We can start to live that eternal life that we have in Jesus Christ even today, if only we enter into this paradox and turn away from our know-it-all understanding of how to function in the world and how others should function in the world, right? It's not about, that's not how you do that over there. Friend, come back. Right? Like, that's not what this is about. We can invite people into something, but it isn't about forcing them into this relationship with Jesus Christ. Conversion, in fact, is God's work to do. We can invite, but conversion is, in fact, the work of the Holy Spirit. When we surrender to how we think it should go, you know, like that lesson that Peter had to learn too. When we surrender to how we think it should go, we find that we end up with more joy, more hope as we live God's way of life. So in this Lent, as we work to see the ways that God is healing our relationships, healing our sin, our wrong priorities, and now our know-it-allness, we pray that God would help us to surrender and find the new life that God in Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit brings, even now in these moments. Amen. Thank you. We are so grateful for all of you who have continued to give to the church throughout the pandemic. Your faithful giving has made it possible for us to continue to be in ministry with one another, to continue to serve the missions that we do. For your generosity, we give thanks. And many of you, while your circumstances have changed, you have found ways to reach out and continue to serve your neighbors. And we're grateful for that kind of giving as well. There are many ways to serve our Lord, and your generosity continues to amaze every day. So let us now turn to our God and dedicate all of these gifts. Lord, we celebrate that you have given us gifts that we can share. We celebrate that we are able to offer something back to you, whether large or small. You have taught us that the size of the gift is not the point. You want us to give with our whole heart. Help us to do that today and always. Expand the time, money, service, prayers, witness, and presence that we give for your will, so that people who don't know you would come to know your love and forgiveness. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 77, How Great Thou Art.
My God, how great. great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Ah, that's always a good hymn to sing and hear and be a part of. We go forth with blessing. As we go from worship today, may it be with an attitude that humbles ourselves before God.
We will listen for God's instruction and serve where we are called.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And also with you. Amen.